Welcome to this module. In this module, we will ask ourselves why a new approach to urban sanitation is needed.
Take a second to think about sanitation in your city. What do you observe? Did your city reach 100% sanitation coverage? Is there improved sanitation for everyone? Probably not.
What you will see is that downtown and the middle and high-income areas are connected to a sewer network. However, most probably, low-income neighborhoods, informal settlements, and peri-urban areas are not connected to any kind of formal sanitation system. Why is this so?
These unserved areas represent up to 80 or 90% of the urban population. Obviously, past programs did not manage to be inclusive. Which reasons do you see for that?
In our view, one of the reasons is that in the past, sector investment only targeted the extension of the sewer networks. At the same time, many programs failed to integrate or stimulate the existing private sector provider.
It is clear that if cities are to be fully served within a decade, a mix of sanitation systems and services are needed. A number of large funding agencies have become aware of that, and we believe that you can be instrumental in this paradigm change. In this module, we will look at urbanization trends, at the global urban sanitation situation, and how it is monitored. We will assess the health impact of unsafely managed sanitation. And finally, we will look at sanitation in the Sustainable Development Goals and where you can find relevant information. The animation behind me illustrates the growth of most cities in low and middle-income countries. Most cities are growing fast, especially the informal settlements and peri-urban areas. Middle and high-income housing are also developing, sometimes replacing informal settlements, or as new neighborhoods or gated communities in the city periphery. At the same time, villages and smaller towns are absorbed by the expanding city.
Our future is urban. This map shows the cities planned to have more than 1 million inhabitants in 2030. Although the number of megacities is increasing, most population growth is taking place in secondary towns. How many of these do you have in your country? Keeping up with this urbanization trend is a huge challenge for governments, especially when it comes to basic services such as water supply and sanitation.
The Joint Monitoring Programme, or JMP, led by the World Health Organization and UNICEF, is in charge of monitoring the progress of sanitation worldwide. We encourage you to go and check their website and see the data they have collected for your country. On this graph, we can clearly see that urban access to improved sanitation is not inclusive. Sanitation access is directly related to wealth, and the wealthiest people have higher access to sanitation. This is not new, but let's remember that access to water and sanitation is a basic human right.
Unfortunately, most of the urban growth happens in the form of informal settlements, which may look like this. Providing basic services in such areas is definitely a challenge, but it should be taken up. It's a matter of governance and equity.
We have just been showing pictures of low-income neighborhoods. Do you have some like this in your city? Even though they may be spatially confined, they are deeply connected to the city through numerous flows, especially of people working and studying. And what happens here has a direct impact on the whole city. Environmental pollution cannot be contained, nor can the economic impact of poor sanitation on society. This figure, developed by WHO, highlights the different disease transmission routes and how unsafe sanitation may impact our health. As you can see, sanitation hazards can happen along the whole sanitation service chain. Think, for example, about unsafe toilets or septic tanks overflowing on the streets or fecal sludge being dumped in the drain. Then, daily life may bring us involuntarily in contact with sanitation-related pathogens. Think about flies, fresh vegetables from urban agriculture, or contaminated groundwater. And as a hand-washing specialist will tell you, pathogens also spread through contact with contaminated surfaces and dirty hands. Children are especially at stake. Finally, the higher the exposure, the higher the chances you have to get sick.
The potential health-related impacts are serious. Numerous diseases, such as diarrhea, typhoid, helminth infection, or even cholera, stunting and the long-lasting effects of stunting, antimicrobial resistance, etc. The health impacts generate huge economic costs, especially through the loss of productivity, which translates into loss of income. There are further economic impacts, like when female teenagers are missing school because of the lack of safe sanitation, which reduces their chances of success. In parallel, the contamination of recreational areas induces a loss of economic benefits, without talking about the contamination of drinking water sources. Studies by the World Bank and WHO show that the economic loss due to poor sanitation amounts to hundreds of millions of dollars every year.
But what is safely managed sanitation? The Joint Monitoring Programme has set two important definitions. Firstly, improved sanitation are facilities which are designed to hygienically separate excreta from human contact. Secondly, safely managed sanitation are systems where the excreta produced is either treated or disposed of in situ, or where the excreta is stored temporarily and then emptied, transported and treated off-site, or where it is transported through a sewer and then treated off-site.
The proportion of population using safely managed sanitation services, including a hand-washing facility with soap and water, is the indicator to measure the Sustainable Development Goal for Sanitation, set by the United Nations, SDG 6.2, which states, by 2030, achieve access to adequate and equitable sanitation and hygiene for all, and end open defecation, paying special attention to the needs of women and girls and those in vulnerable situations.
Unlike the Millennium Development Goals, which only focus on the toilet and containment, the Sustainable Development Goals address the whole sanitation service chain, from toilet to treatment and safe disposal. Citywide inclusive sanitation is the urban response to achieve this target.
However, citywide inclusive sanitation does not only contribute to achieving SDG Goal 6, it also contributes to SDG 3, good health and well-being, SDG 5, gender equality, SDG 7, resource recovery, SDG 11, sustainable cities, SDG 12, circular waste economy. Remember that when you need to advocate this approach to your government or funding agencies.
In this way, citywide inclusive sanitation can become appealing for governments. Just to mention some key incentives. A faster increase of sanitation coverage with equal investment. More sustainability through better stakeholder engagement. The realization of the human right to sanitation in your country. And better scores with SDGs in international comparison. So in summary, why do we talk about citywide inclusive sanitation? This module highlighted that exponential urban growth is a serious challenge for basic service provision worldwide. And it is obvious that business as usual will not be able to cope. Taking a citywide inclusive sanitation approach will help you to address the rapid urban growth, the lack of inclusiveness of current sanitation programs, and find solutions for the entire sanitation service chain, while combining all types of sanitation systems and services. As sanitation professionals, what we want is to reach 100% sanitation coverage. Focusing only on extending the centralized sewer network will not achieve full coverage in the medium term for many cities. Instead, different sanitation systems and services are needed in order to reach everyone in the city. That's what citywide inclusive sanitation is about, and why it is urgently needed.